connecting families. There are so many families struggling with our kids. அவங்களை வளர்க்கறதுக்காக தனித்தனியா நிறைய நம்ம கஷ்டப்பட்டு எல்லாமே பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கோம். ஸோ இந்த மாதிரி இருக்க தனித்தனியா இருக்கவங்க எல்லாம் ஒன்னா சேரும்போது வி கேன் எக்ஸ்சேஞ்ச் இன்ஃபர்மேஷன், அவங்களோட நாலேஜை ஷேர் பண்ணிக்கலாம், நம்மளோட ரிவ்யூஸ் எல்லாம் ஷேர் பண்ணிக்கலாம். ஒருத்தரோட ஒருத்தர் கனெக்டடாக இருக்கும்போது வி கேன் ஹெல்ப் ஈச் அதர். ஸோ அதுதான் ஃபண்டமெண்டல் ரீசன். அதுக்கப்புறம் இஃப் தெர் இஸ் எனி நீட், ஏதாவது ஒரு இடத்துல நம்ம குழந்தைங்களுக்காக நம்ம ஏதாவது ப்ராப்ளம் ஃபேஸ் பண்ணும்போது சிங்கிளாக ஃபேஸ் பண்ணுறதை விட இஃப் யூ ஆர் பீயிங் அ குரூப் இட் வில் பி வெரி ஈஸி, இட் பி மோர் பவர்ஃபுல். நம்ம யுனைட்டடாக இருக்கிறது ரொம்ப முக்கியம் ஃபார் அவர் கிட்ஸ். அதுக்கப்புறம் என்னென்னா, இஃப் யூ வாண்ட் எனி சப்போர்ட் ஃப்ரம் த கவர்மெண்ட், இஃப் எனி திங் சார் ஆர் ஸோ மெனி ஃபீல்ஸ், நிறைய இடத்துல நமக்கு கண்டிப்பாக கவர்மெண்ட்டோட இன்டர்வென்ஷன் தேவைப்படுது. இன்னும் கூட அதெல்லாம் நடக்கலை ஃபார் ரெகுலேட்டிங் த தெரப்பி ஃபீஸ் அண்ட் தெரப்பி சென்டர்ஸ். அதுக்கப்புறம் ஃபார் ஸ்கூல் இன்க்ளூஷன், இந்த மாதிரி நிறைய விஷயங்கள் இருக்குது. இதில் எல்லாத்துலேயுமே நம்ம என்ன பண்ணணும்னா, வி ஹாவ் டு கெட் ஹெல்ப் ஃப்ரம் த கவர்மெண்ட். அதுக்கு வி ஹாவ் டு ஃபார்ம் அ குரூப் டு ரெப்ரசென்ட். ஸோ இதுக்காகவும் தேவைப்படுது. ஸோ தீஸ் ஆர் ஆல் த ரீசன்ஸ் ஒய் வி ஸ்டார்டட் திஸ் குரூப். ஸோ வேர் வி நவ், இப்போ என்ன பண்ணியிருக்கோம் அப்படின்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, 6 months ஆகுது நம்ம இந்த குரூப்பை ஃபார்ம் பண்ணி. இந்த 6 months வி ஹவ் கனெக்டட் 200 ஃபேமிலிஸ். அவர் குரூப் நம்ம குரூப்பில் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 200 ஃபேமிலிஸ் வந்து மெம்பர்ஸாக இருக்காங்க. அதுக்கப்புறம் இதில் நாங்கள் என்னெல்லாம் பண்ணியிருக்கோம்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, வி ஹேட் 5 sessions ஃபார் பேரண்ட்ஸ் இன் வேரியஸ் டாபிக்ஸ். அதுக்கப்புறம் வி ஹேட் 1 topic இன் ஸ்போர்ட்ஸ், தட் இஸ் ஸ்பெஷல் ஒலிம்பிக்ஸில். அதுக்காக வி ஹேட் அன் அசஸ்மெண்ட் செஷன் ஆல்சோ வித் பால் சார். ஹீ இஸ் த டைரக்டர் ஆஃப் ஸ்பெஷல் ஒலிம்பிக்ஸ், அதோட டைரக்டர் அவர். அவர்கிட்ட ஒரு அசஸ்மெண்ட் கேம்ப் கூட நம்ம குழந்தைங்களுக்காக நாங்கள் ஆர்கனைஸ் பண்ணியிருந்தோம். அதுக்கப்புறம் தனியாக ஒரு 1.5 day ஒர்க் ஷாப் இருந்துச்சு, எதுக்குன்னா பிஹேவியர் மேனேஜ்மெண்ட்டுக்கு. ஸோ இதெல்லாம் வந்து நம்ம ஒன்னா குரூப்பில் இருந்ததுனால இதெல்லாம் நம்மளால் பண்ண முடிஞ்சது இந்த பாஸ்ட் 6 months. வேர் வி வாண்ட் டு கோ, என்ன பண்ணணும் அப்படிங்கிறது நம்மளோட ஆசைனா, ஒரு காலத்தில் ஒரு சொசைட்டியில் போகும்போது நம்ம குழந்தை இண்டிபெண்ட்டாக போயிட்டு வரணும் எல்லா இடத்துக்கும். பப்ளிக்காக அக்சஸ் பண்ணி எத்தனை பேர் நிம்மதியாக விடுறோம் குழந்தைங்கள, போட போய் பார்க்கில் விளையாடிட்டு வான்னு அனுப்பிடுறோமா, போய் வெளியே விளையாடிட்டு வான்னு அனுப்பிடுறோமா. நம்ம குழந்தை கொஞ்சம் விவரமாக வந்துட்டால் கூட நமக்கு பயமாக இருக்கும், யார் என்ன சொல்வாங்களோ, என்ன பண்ணிடுவானோ, ஏதாவது ஆயிடுமோ. ஸோ இன்னுமே நமக்கு ஃப்ரீ அக்சசபிலிட்டி விட முடியல. அதே மாதிரி எங்கேயாவது கூட்டிகிட்டு போகிறதுனா கூட நிறைய பேருக்கு ஒரு பயம் இருக்கும், யார் என்ன சொல்லிடுவாங்களோ, சத்தம் போடுவானோ, அந்த மாதிரிலாம். இந்த மாதிரி எந்த ஒரு பயமும் இல்லாமல் எல்லா பிளேஸுக்குமே குழந்தைங்களுக்கு அக்சசபிலிட்டி போயிட்டு வர மாதிரி இருக்கணும். நெக்ஸ்ட் வந்து எஜுகேஷன், வி ஹவ் டு என்ஷூர் த எஜுகேஷன் ஆஃப் த சைல்டு. நம்ம குழந்தை கண்டிப்பாக ஸ்பெஷல் சைல்டுனால சில சில ப்ராப்ளம்ஸ் இருக்கும், லேர்னிங் டிஃபிகல்ட்டிஸ் இருக்கும். நார்மல் ஸ்கூலில் வி ஃபேஸ் லாட் ஆஃப் ப்ராப்ளம்ஸ். இது வந்து என்னென்னா, ஆல்ரெடி ஐ ஹவ் டோல்ட் யூ 5 sessions நம்ம கண்டக்ட் பண்ணியிருக்கோம், அசஸ்மெண்ட்லாம் ஜஸ்ட் அ கிளிப்பிங் ஆஃப் இட். தீஸ் ஆர் த 5 sessions. ஃபஸ்ட்டு மீட்டிங் வி ஹாவ் ஹாப்பி பேரண்டிங் அண்ட் டிசேபிலிட்டி ரைட்ஸ். அதில் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா பாலபாரதிங்கிறவர், ஹீ இஸ் அ ஜேர்னலிஸ்ட் அண்ட் ஆர்டிசம் ரைட் ஆக்டிவிஸ்ட். அப்புறம் டிஎம்என் தீபக், டிசேபிலிட்டி ரைட்ஸ் ஆக்டிவிஸ்ட், இவங்க தான் அட்ரஸ் பண்ணாங்க அந்த மீட்டிங்கை. செகண்ட் மீட்டிங் வி ஹேட் ஆன் இன்க்ளூஷன் இன் ஸ்கூல்ஸ். அதில் ஆவி கிரிதர்ங்கிறவர், ஹீ இஸ் அ ஸ்பெஷல் எஜுகேட்டர் அண்ட் ஒர்க்கிங் ஃபார் இன்க்ளூஷன். அந்த ஸ்கூலில் எப்படி வந்து வாட் ஆர் த திங்ஸ் வி ஹவ் டு இன்க்ளூட், என்னெல்லாம் வந்து நம்ம ஒரு சாதாரண ஸ்கூலில் இந்த மாதிரி ஸ்பெஷல் குழந்தைங்களை இன்க்ளூட் பண்ணணும்னா அந்த ஸ்கூல் எப்படியெல்லாம் அடாப்ட் பண்ணிக்கணும், அவங்களோட டெக்னாலஜி டெக்னிக்ஸு இதெல்லாம் எப்படி இருக்கணும், கம்யூனிகேஷன் டெக்னிக்ஸ், டீச்சிங் டெக்னிக்ஸ், இந்த இதில் ஒர்க் பண்ணுறவர் கிரிதர்ங்கிறவர். அப்புறம் வனிதா ஆண்டி இருக்காங்க நம்ம கூட, அவங்க வந்து மோட்டிவேஷ்னல் ஸ்பீச், அவங்க ஜேர்னியை பற்றி நம்ம கூட ஷேர் பண்ணாங்க. தேர்ட் பிஹேவியர் மேனேஜ்மெண்ட் அண்ட் காக்னிட்டிவ் ட்ரைனிங் இருந்துச்சு. இவங்க ரெண்டு பேருமே ரீஹாபிடேஷன் சைக்காலஜிஸ்ட்டு, நிப்மெட்ல இருந்தவங்க ப்ரொஃபஸர்ஸ் தான், தனபாண்டியன் சார் அண்ட் கிருஷ்ணமூர்த்தி சார். தனபாண்டியன் சார் எதுக்கு அட்ரஸ் பண்ணாங்கன்னா, வாட் ஆர் த பிஹேவியர் இஷ்யூஸ், ஹவு டு மேனேஜ் அதை பற்றி. காக்னிட்டிவ் ட்ரைனிங்கை பற்றி கிருஷ்ணமூர்த்தி சார் எக்ஸ்பிளைன் பண்ணியிருந்தாங்க. ஃபோர்த் மீட்டிங் வி ஹாவ் ஆன் ஹவு ஸ்போர்ட்ஸ் கேன் ஹெல்ப், அதுக்கு தான் பால் தேவசாயம் ஃப்ரம் தமிழ் ஸ்பெஷல் ஒலிம்பிக்ஸ் அவர் வந்திருந்தார். ஸ்போர்ட்ஸ் எப்படி தான் குழந்தைங்களுக்கு ஹெல்ப் பண்ணணும்னு பேசினாங்க. அதாவது கண்டினியூஷனாக நம்ம என்ன பண்ணியிருக்கோம்னா, நிறைய லோக்கல் குரூப்ஸ் ஃபார்ம் பண்ணியிருக்கோம். இப்போ அசஸ்மெண்ட் முடிச்சிட்டோம், நெக்ஸ்ட் வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு ஹேவ் அவர் ரிப்போர்ட்ஸும் வந்துருச்சு. இன்றைக்கி எல்லா பேரண்ட்ஸ் வந்துட்டவங்க கலெக்ட் பண்ணிக்கோங்க, உங்கள் குழந்தையோட அசஸ்மெண்ட் யார் அட்டன் பண்ணிங்களோ அவங்களோட அசஸ்மெண்ட் ரிப்போர்ட் ரெடியாக இருக்குது, மறக்காமல் வாங்கிக்கோங்க. அவங்களுக்கு இனி வந்து கிளாஸஸ் எப்போங்கிறத இனி நம்ம ஃபர்தராக மூவ் பண்ணுவோம். இது வந்து இதோட கண்டினியூவேஷன் ஸ்போர்ட்ஸில். அதுக்கடுத்தது டிசேபிலிட்டி ரைட்ஸ் பற்றி டிஎம் தீபக்ங்கிறவங்க பேசினாங்க. ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் த அசஸ்மெண்ட் ஃபார் ஸ்பெஷல் ஒலிம்பிக்ஸ் நடந்துச்சுன்னு சொன்னேன் இல்லையா. அந்த அன்னைக்கு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 22 kids அட்டன் பண்ணியிருந்தாங்க. அவங்களோட அசஸ்மெண்ட் நடந்ததோட ஃபியூ கிளிப்பிங்ஸ் இது. நெக்ஸ்ட்டு வந்து This is behavior management workshop for 3 hours. $100-$200 For managing the expenses, nammaloada tea selavu matha arrangements kaga. All these professionals are very service minded. They are offering for free. They wanted to help the parents. Nammaloada group oda innoru vishayam enna na oru side la theva padravanga irupanga needs, innoru pakkam people ready to serve. Adha rendayum bridge pandradha correct ana professionals kuda ungala connect pandradhukaga dhaan indha group. Adhu dhaan main okayla. அதுக்கப்புறம் இது லாஸ்ட் ஒன்று பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, நம்ம குரூப் மூலமாக நம்ம பண்ணியிருக்க ஒரு முக்கியமான விஷயம் என்னென்னா, இப்போ நம்மளோட ப்ராப்ளம்ஸ் எல்லாம் நம்ம சொல்லும்போது எஸ்சிபிசிஆர்னு சொல்லுவாங்க, அதாவது ஸ்டேட் கமிஷன் ஃபார் ஃபிசிக்கலி சேலஞ்ச் சில்ட்ரன். இப்போ இந்த எஸ்சிபிசிஆரில் போய் நம்ம சொல்லணும்னா, அங்கே இருக்கிறவங்களுக்கு ஃபஸ்ட்டு நம்மளோட பிரச்சனையை பற்றி புரியணும். இப்போ பார்த்தீங்கன்னா பிளைண்ட்னா அவங்களுக்கு ஒரு வேறு மாதிரியான ஒரு பிரச்சனைகள் இருக்கும். இப்போ காது கேட்காத குறை இருக்கவங்க பார்த்தீங்கன்னா அவங்களோட பிரச்சனை வேறு. ஆனால் இங்கே எல்லாத்த விட அதிக பிரச்சனை வேறு மாதிரி பிரச்சனை இருக்கிறது பார்த்தீங்கன்னா நம்ம குழந்தைங்க தான். ஸோ நம்ம குழந்தைங்களுக்கு ஒரு டிசேபிலிட்டி சொல்ல முடியாது, ஃபோக்கஸ் பண்ண முடியாது, லேர்னிங் டிசேபிலிட்டி இருக்கலாம், சில குழந்தைங்களால கன்வே கம்யூனிகேட் பண்ண முடியாது. ஸோ நம்ம எல்லாமே நிறைய பார்த்தீங்கன்னா மல்டிபிள் டிசேபிலிட்டி கேட்டகரியில் வருவோம். ஸோ பிளைண்ட் இருக்கவங்களுக்கு நம்ம குழந்தைய பற்றி தெரியணுங்கிற ஃபுல்லாக தெரியும்னு நம்ம சொல்ல முடியாது. அதனால் நம்ம என்ன பண்ணோன்னா, எப்போ ஒரு டிசேபிலிட்டி அந்த கவுன்சிலுக்கு ஒரு மெம்பரை நீங்கள் அலோகேட் பண்ணும்போது அந்த மெம்பருக்கு ஆட்டிசமோட டீட்டெயில்ஸ் தெரிஞ்சிருக்கணும். எதர் ஆட்டிசம் பேரண்டாக இருக்கலாம், இல்லைன்னா அந்த குழந்தைங்களோட ஒர்க் பண்ணவங்களாக இருக்கலாம். கண்டிப்பாக எங்கள் டிசேபிலிட்டியை பற்றி தெரிஞ்சவங்கள தான் நீங்கள் அந்த மெம்பராக போடணும்னு சொல்லி நாங்கள் ஒரு லெட்டர் கொடுத்துருந்தோம். அதை கேட்டு இப்போ ஒருத்தங்களை அப்பாயிண்ட் பண்ணியிருக்காங்கங்கிற நியூஸும் எனக்கு கிடச்சிச்சு. அதனால் ரொம்ப ஹாப்பி அந்த விஷயத்தில். தேங்க்யூ வெரி மச். ஸோ இதெல்லாம் ஒரு 6 மந்த்ஸில் நம்ம எல்லாம் ஒன்றா சேர்ந்ததுனால நம்மளால் இவ்வளோ பண்ண முடியுது. கண்டிப்பாக நம்ம நிறைய இன்னும் ஃப்யூச்சரில் வில் ஹாவ் மோர் செஷன்ஸ், மோர் டாபிக்ஸ், மோர் திங்ஸ் ஃபார் அவர் கிட்ஸ். ஒன்லி திங் இஸ் வி ஹவ் டு ஸ்டே யுனைடட். அவ்வளோதான். தேங்க்யூ வெரி மச் ஃபார் யுவர் பேஷன்ஸ் டு லிசன் அபவுட் திஸ் குரூப். தேங்க்யூ வெரி மச். ஸோ டுடேஸ் டாபிக் இஸ் ஸ்பீச் அண்ட் லாங்குவேஜ் டெவலப்மெண்ட். நான் சொல்லவே வேணும், அந்த டாப்பிக்காக தான் நிறைய புது மூலம்லாம் வந்திருக்கீங்க. வெரி ஹாப்பி டு சி யூ ஆல். வந்து ஸ்பீச் அண்ட் லாங்குவேஜ் டெவலப்மெண்ட்டில் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, நமக்கு அதை பற்றி பேசுறதுக்காக வி ஹாவ் 3 பர்சன்ஸ், ஹிமஜா ரெட்டி, ஷெனாஸ், மோனிகா. திஸ் 3 பீப்புள் நீங்கள் ரொம்ப எப்படி எதிர்பார்த்தது, என்னடா காலேஜ் ஸ்டூடெண்ட் மாதிரி இருக்காங்களேன்னு யோசிக்கலாம். பட் என்னோட பர்சனல் எக்ஸ்பீரியன்ஸ், தே ஆர் வெரி குட் அண்ட் டைனமிக். ஒன் திங், ஹூ ஆர் யூ ஆர் காலிங் ஃபார் அவர் மீட்டிங், அவங்கக்கிட்ட ஃபஸ்ட்டு நான் இங்கே எதிர்பார்க்குற ஒரே விஷயம், தே சுட் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் த ப்ராப்ளம் ஆஃப் பேரண்ட்ஸ். பேரண்ட்ஸோட கஷ்டம் புரிஞ்சவங்களாக இருக்கணும். தே ஆர் ரெடி டு ஹெல்ப் த பேரண்ட்ஸாக இருக்கணும். அந்த குழந்தைங்களோட எந்த அளவுக்கு கனெக்டடாக, ஹவு தே ஆர் ஒர்க்கிங், வாட் ரிசல்ட் வி ஆர் கெட்டிங், வாட் ரெவ்யூ வி ஆர் கெட்டிங் ஃப்ரம் த பேரண்ட்ஸ். இவ்வளோ தான். இந்த கேட்டகரியில் தான் நார்மலாக நம்ம எல்லா ப்ரொஃபஷன்ஸ் கூப்பிட்றதும் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, அவங்க எந்த அளவுக்கு பேரண்ட்ஸ்க்கு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங்காக இருக்காங்க, how much they are ready to serve our kids, how much they are connecting, what is the review. Based on that, we are having a pakka review of these 3 dynamic persons. Kandipa the meeting mudinjona you will have more ideas, you will be happy to attend this meeting. Pa, thank you very much for coming. The dais is for the 3 dynamic people.
Speech and language, the different modes of communication that are used to communicate, and also the disorders that exist primarily in children is what we're going to discuss today. And then we're going to look at why do we need to intervene in cases of children who exhibit these communication disorders, and followed by we're going to look at how we help them out in these interventions. Moving on to what? Communication, as we all know, is very essential for all of us, communicate our needs and send messages, and for the other person to pick it up. So when an infant cries, you know, the mother attends to the child. When a child in the class raises his hand, the teacher immediately attends to him and asks him, you know, if she can help him. And if your child, tucks your dress, it means that, you know, he wants something from you. So all of these that I've just mentioned are non-verbal modalities. In addition to this, obviously we also have our verbal modality that we use to communicate. So for one, to communicate, like I just said, we use various different modalities, depending on which ones the individual is comfortable with. So So looking further into exactly what is speech and language, which is what communication encompasses of. Language is what one needs to possess to basically understand anyone's messages. And that is divided into form, that is a basic structure that is included in the language. Content, which is meaning, understanding what meaning. Like if I don't know that this is a microphone, I will not be able to ask for one, right? So understanding what the object stands for. And again, the object use. So I know that I'm going to address to the group, and what I need right now is a microphone. So I understand that this is what is going to, you know, enhance my loudness to the rest of the group. So understanding that again is the use. And moving on to speech. So speech is one of the modalities that we use to express, but it's the most primary modality that's used across. We should all remember that speech is basically dependent on language. So, you know, if you do not possess language and if somebody is speaking, it would just be meaningless utterances that are put together. It would make no sense at all. It could be like, you know, I say ba ba ba, you know, it makes no sense because I don't know what that means, right? That's why it's very important that you work on language when you're trying to simultaneously improve the child's speech. So I see many parents who, you know, where they're unaware and they just sit down with the child and they go on like, you know, say hi, say bye, and with this absolutely no content. It's never going to make sense to the child when he's actually leaving the room. Would he say hi then just because you taught him hi, you know, just sitting down with him? No, he would not, right? Because he doesn't know what's the situation that he needs to use that particular word. So that's why speech is majorly dependent on language and they go hand in hand. And followed by that, like I just said, speech is the primary modality, but there's always other modalities, which is gestures, facial expressions, signs, and everything. So you know, if my phone is ringing here and I pick it up to answer, I'm using my auditory modality. If I meet a friend after a really long time and I hug her, it's showing, it's communicating to her that I'm really happy to see her, right? And so those are my expressions and the feelings that are important. So in addition to speech, all of these always, you know, make wholesome communication. So expanding a little bit into that, we're looking at the communication umbrella right here. So like I just said, when we communicate, it's not just verbal, it also encompasses your non-verbal as well as your AAC mode. So verbal obviously includes sentences, your words, sounds, and all of those. Followed by your non-verbal is going to predominantly include eyes and facial expression, gestures, how well spaced you are from your communication partner, and the kind of tonality you use to communicate to them, right? And then the AAC mode is basically, you know, you use some kind of device or something that augments or alternates the current mode of speech that you're using with your kid. Okay, so I hope all of you are clear about speech and language and what exactly is communication. Again, I would like to highlight that communication is, you know, is a major division under which speech and language come under, which also includes non-verbal. And I would like to clarify that non-verbal is not something you would work on just when your child cannot speak. It's also something you guys need to emphasize right even when the child is very young. Right? Now when I'm talking to you, I'm not talking to you like, okay, you know, this is what I'm trying to tell you. Now what's happening? No, I'm not doing it. I'm moving around. I'm, you know, looking back and forth. And, you know, also my body language is delivering a lot of message. So that's important as well. We don't want our kids to majorly just grow up and, you know, be robotic. That's definitely not what we want. We want to, you know, typicalize them as much as we can and empower the existing mode of communication we have. Proximity is how the distance you maintain with your communication partner, right? Which is also very essential. Now, if I go like really close to her and I'm talking, it would make her uncomfortable.
You can disturb their observation.
I think we are. Would you like to? You know, knowing that you're supposed to maintain a distance is what is essential, right? Knowing that if I'm doing a formal, address, I'm having a particular distance, whereas if I'm hanging out with my friends, I would be a lot more closer, right? Yeah, you had something else? Prosody is the kind of tone you use, the inflections in your language. So again, that which is very important, like I just said, we don't want them to just go like, hi, my name is Shenaz.
what is going on? Yeah, you know, how are you doing? No. Like, hi, my name is Shenaz. You know, those inflections also make a wholesome communication, and that's also what you guys need to focus on. Okay, so now looking at, I hope you're all clear about what exactly is communication and the different aspects that fall under that. Having learned that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a certain red flags. I was told that almost all of us gathered here already are into therapies, like the kids are into therapies. Anyway, I'm just going to put these. So while I put these on, what you guys can do is probably gauge which level your child fits into and maybe make a note of that. Yeah? So under 18 months, when I don't see my child making expressions back and forth to the parent by 6 months, and there's no back and forth sharing or maybe smiling, and you know, by 9 months, and then when I don't notice babbling, I have joint attention by around 12 months. Joint attention is, I don't know if a lot of people are aware here, joint attention is basically, I look at this, I drop this paper and I look down. Okay, so I just look down and I pick it up. Okay, and instead I drop the paper down, I look at her, I look at the paper and I pick it up. So I'm communicating to her that I've actually dropped something, and I would maybe like her to pick it up, or just making her understand, okay, you know, I've dropped it. Okay, so which is very essential for kids to develop, to have enjoying interaction going on. And also, if I don't see by 14 months, pointing or objects of interest, they don't understand simple common words like amma or milk or other basic words that exist in their environment. And not using any words at all by 16 months, and is not emitting any gross motor movements like, you know, I clap, I go bye bye, but my child isn't doing that. Why? So that's a certain red flag that should probably worry you guys. Okay, now by 18 months, I would expect them to say at least 8 to 10 meaningful words. I would also, it's a problem if I don't see them concretely in simple commands like go close the door or, come give this to me. Does not follow your pointing with his gaze, again something like joint attention. Is not playing pretend with items, like, you know, doesn't pick up the phone and pretend to talk on the phone even though it's not ringing. And also does not play in proximity to other children, right? So alongside appropriate proximity, and also just not being around them at all should also worry us. So these should probably attain by 18 months, and if you don't see that, it should raise an alert. And then by 2 years, what I would want them to start developing is two-word combinations, and also, you know, start developing simple two-step commands. And at least 50% of speech is understandable, not just to you, but also maybe to the people around in the child's life. And also they should start being able to point into pictures and particularly ask. Like you're sitting with a book and reading it with your child, and you know, you might go like, oh, my child actually reads the book. But is he, you know, when you name or pick a particular item, is he actually pointing to that respective item? So if they don't do any of these, then it's probably an issue which should have been attained by 2 years. So you might want to get help immediately. And then by 3 years again, so it's very easy to remember, you know, by 1 year you need one word levels, by 2 years you start phrases that need to start coming in, and then by 3 years there's more sentences that start coming in, like 3 to 4. And speech is much more understandable, which is at least 75%. And child begins to leave the beginnings or end of most words. He is unable to accurately answer yes no questions, cannot answer simple language questions like what's your name, who is this, and so on. And also does not play along with other children or doesn't pay interest at all when you take him to the park or other scenarios. And also experiencing stuttering behavior for more than 6 months. Obviously the first ones you saw, except for this one and the last one, is more pertaining to language as such, whereas the speech and, you know, stuttering behaviors are more speech based. Okay, so, and between 4 to 5 years, obviously speech is much more understandable to everyone, not just the immediate parent or caretaker. The child begins to use much more complex sentences, begins to narrate and sequence, like, you know, he's able to start saying, oh, I woke up, I went to the bathroom, I brushed my teeth. Okay, he's also having difficulty with the proper grammar, which is again the form of language, and cannot tell a simple story. has difficulty answering simple WH questions and is not yet able to name a few letters, numbers and writing words, which is literacy skills, which is what we're going to look into a little further on. I think that makes us marks the end of red flags. I hope you all try to, you know, put down your kids in each of these levels. If you have any discussions, we could do it towards the end. So, like we just discussed, speech, language and the different modes of communication available, we're going to look at what exactly are the communication disorders, like what happens if my child has any of these difficulties and where exactly do I put him under, okay? Now, before I go into that, I would like to highlight that there are different schools of thoughts, you know. You try to work on therapy pertaining exactly to the diagnosis, but I would like you guys to remember, especially with language disorders, you wouldn't want to stick around the term. As such, addresses the inclusion as a whole, regardless of the disorder. Okay, so language disorders are primarily preschool-based disorders, which start to get noticed by around 2 to 5 years of age. And these kids exhibit delayed speech and language, delayed receptive, which is understanding of language, and also expression. So, followed by there's also basic language-based learning disabilities that you start noticing. And then there are speech disorders, speech sound disorders, which is primarily like the child is unable to, you know, articulate the right sound or has other phonological issues. Stuttering is basically stammering, right? I hope you guys are familiar with that. And then there's childhood apraxia of speech and voice disorders. Today we're going to try and focus on language disorders. If you guys have any doubts about that, you can come contact us in person. And then followed by developmental disorders, which includes ADHD and ASD, and medical, which is cleft of lip and palate. Okay, now that we've looked into why and what exactly are the disorders, I'm sure all of us gathered here with the intention to promote better communication skills with our kids, right? And I'm also sure none of us would like to argue why do we need to intervene. If there's anybody in that category, you can like show me by raise of hands. But the reason why we're all here is because we know that, you know, how important intervention is. So I'm trying to address you guys about, I'm trying to raise an alert, not to, you know, try to get you guys worked up, but to make you understand how important it is to start early. Okay? I will be specifying a particular age group, but then if your child is above that, don't worry, just go ahead and get started right away. So many research has been done about intervention. The research states that when the child develops until about 5 years, the brain is basically very plastic. Okay, so when you try to teach anything to the child, it's easier to mold, and the child picks up skills much faster than an older child or even an adult. That's primarily why adults children pick up second languages much more easier than an adult. Like I have my family, people who help us out at home, and they moved in from Nepal, and the parents haven't picked up Tamil at all. But you know, the kids were really young when they came, they speak really fluently. So it pertains to a critical period, which is to do with your brain development. So advice would be to go ahead and get help as immediately as you can. Okay, now that we've decided to get intervention, how do we help these kids during intervention? So you might obviously want to contact your speech language pathologist pertaining to communication as such, but then multi-specialty approach of even your OTs and ABAs and everyone together will really, depending on the child's need, will be helpful as well. So these are just the basics. We might highlight these later on, but today we're going to stick to basics. So looking at language development first. So I know that my child has a language issue. Now what exactly do I do with him? So your speech pathologist is going to begin to start focusing on his receptive language, which is how well your child understands the language, and simultaneously also going to work on expressive language, right? Because like I just said, we don't want them to just blurt out words which make no sense to them or others, and you know, they go hand in hand. And so expressive language can be speech, but there are also other things that we use. There's AAC, which is PECS. I don't know how many of you are familiar with that. It's basically picture exchange communication system. And there's AVAS and then Prolog 2. So all of these are apps that are developed, but that are available on your app stores or your play stores, depending on which device you use. So again, I know a lot of you might have the question about why do I do AAC? And you know, wouldn't it hamper if I just do AAC and would speech be underdeveloped? We will answer to that in our FAQs. We'll look into that a little further. Anyway, when exactly do you start AACs? It depends on a lot of factors. It depends on your child's age, existing form of communication, motor dexterity to be able to use any kind of devices, and so on. So that's exactly what your speech pathologist would work on in your language development. And while they're working on these receptive and expressive skills, they would start focusing on these four things. Your speech session basically revolve around these, right? And under these, we pick up goals and, you know, we try to work on these skills. But these are like the broad categories that we work on. So first, your speech pathologist primarily begins working on the child's understanding. And again, this depends on the child's stage of communication. If the child is like, you know, in a very basic stage, like where he's not speaking a lot of words, or his primary mode of communication is just through cry, then we start building more understanding of single word and single sound level. Whereas if a child comes to us with a much more developed language where he's able to express his needs, then I might start working on, following simple commands and so on. So I'm sure your speech pathologist helps you pick up goals according to these. And then next thing we should focus on are the child's interaction skills, okay? Under these, I would like you guys to remember, now for anybody to interact, if I want to interact with her, and she's just talking and I'm looking at her, do you think there would be a possible interaction that would go on?
No.
I might turn and look back at her, but what if my joint attention skills are poor? Considering it is, and I'm looking away and she's trying to make a conversation, it's not going to happen because I'm not paying attention. So first, what we need to start with our kids is helping them develop attention, okay, which is very important. If your child is not giving you good attention in a particular skill or something else that's going on, he's not going to pick up, you know, anything out of that. He's not going to retain it in his long-term memory as well. So that's your first and foremost thing that we're going to try and consider. Followed by, and once he's got his attention, what I'm going to try and work on is, building the child's ability to be able to initiate a conversation with me as well as respond, okay? And again, here, I would like to highlight that most of the times what happens is, we just want our kids to speak. So, you know, many times we forget that it's also important for him to come and initiate a conversation with me when I'm not asking him, you know, question after question. Okay, so when he's just playing by himself, and the whole time, like I let him be for 45 minutes, he doesn't speak anything at all. And then I go and I ask him, oh, what are you doing? And he says, oh, I'm playing, mommy, or, you know, I'm building blocks. So, but why did he tell me something about what he was doing while he was playing? That probably signifies that his initiation is not that great. So you might want, that's why it's very important to be able to build conversations back and forth. And then we also work on reason to communicate. Obviously there needs to be an intention for your child to communicate. Like if I wasn't presenting here, I wouldn't have asked for the microphone, right? Or even a simpler example, like if I'm not hungry, I'm not gonna ask for food. So the child needs to have a basic reason in order to be able to communicate. If you don't build up on the intention to communicate, he's never going to want to communicate with you. So you might want to start developing his intentions. How do we exactly do that? I think we'll do that later. Today's topic of interest is not including that. And followed by way to communicate. Okay, now my child is paying good attention skills. He's also, has an intent to communicate. But why is he not communicating? Because he doesn't have a chosen mode of communication, okay? Which is again what we're going to try and help our kids with. Is he going to use a verbal mode? Is he going to use non-verbal mode? Or is he going to use a combination of both, which is most advisable? That again, you need to take an informed decision with amongst your family and with your speech pathologist. So yeah, that's primarily what we're going to try. We'll be trying to work on in language development. So having looked into that, what I'll do is I'll display a few pointers here for you guys to look at and what exactly you could work on. So if your child isn't communicating with words at the moment, you would want to start putting messages into words. Which means, if your child is looking at this paper, but he's insane, so I'm just looking. So you might want to come say paper, you know, look, it's paper, right? So you start, what you need to do is you need to start pretending like your child is actually, you know, sending direct messages to you. So when you bring about that thought in your mind, you will start making the environment more communicative for him, and then you eventually pick what it means, because what was happening is he was looking at paper and he heard paper. So he starts making that association of word to object, right? Whereas if he's looking here and I'm constantly trying to work on paper, and he hears paper, and whereas he's looking at the laptop. So when he looks at the laptop, maybe later when he gets work, when he says paper, and we, it doesn't make sense to us, right? So we don't want that happening. So you might want to observe him a lot more about what he's doing, what he's paying attention to, and start putting messages into words. And also, so again, it now, okay, I'm doing that, I'm trying to help my child and putting messages into words, but it doesn't mean, you know, a lot of parents, I know a lot of therapy centers might probably tell you, like, speak a lot to your child, like, you know, keep going on and on, but parents might not be aware of how exactly do I need to speak. So they go back home and they just keep going on and on and on, not giving the child a reason to communicate, so the child doesn't have an opportunity to say a word. So while you're doing that, you might want to pause a few instances and wait to see if your child is actually communicating. If he does not, obviously what we're going to do is not keep going again and again and asking him the same question. He's obviously not understood that. So again, I pitch in and then I help him out and put the message into words. Okay. And then again, I would pause more frequently in familiar routines for making more turn-y things to happen, like this would include basic routines like going to bedtime, taking a bath, dressing up, right? So obviously again, what we're trying to do is, in addition to promoting their language ability, we're also trying to make them more independent, okay? You don't want to be buttoning your child's shirt when he's 12 years old. That's not what we want to do. So while you're working on these familiar routines, which also, you know, develop the motor skills, you might want to start adding some words to these routines, and because they happen every day, you, and then you can begin to stop and pause and see if he's actually saying the word. Okay, like for example, if every day you go out, before you go out and you put on the child's shoes, you say out or you say shoes, okay? So you do that repetitively, and finally, you know, you've taken enough turns, you've done it in a routine, and then what you do is you begin to pause, and instead of immediately, you know, talking and not giving him an opportunity, you wait to see if your child actually says shoes. Okay? You can cue to him to come up with that word, you can do a lot of pointing, you can cue that word by you know that. But if he still doesn't do, then again obviously I'm gonna put the word. And again, it's really advisable, especially so right now we're talking about kids who are not using words. So it's better to start using fun words, because number one, it consists more of vowels, which are much more easier to speak than consonants. And also they're just basically fun, right? So if I'm playing with a car and I'm going like, oh look, the car is going, and it's they're hitting it against each other, or they fell down, you know, I would rather just replace that, all of that, which is like crash, or you know, even dumb or anything like that. It's just speaking so many things for a child who's not even using any word, okay? Basically speak lesser for this stage of communication. And also again, like we just said, talk about routines using the same kind of vocabulary. And while you're doing all of these, make sure you use gestures, actions, and other demonstrations while playing, okay? To make the child's communication an overall experience. And then for a child who's just beginning to talk, you guys can have a look at this. If you have any inspiration, I can help you out. Yeah. Okay, so beginning to talk, and then finally for children who are already speaking in sentences, what you would try? Start to talk? Okay, I can go ahead and do that. So beginning to talk, she tells me that most kids here are just beginning to talk and pay attention to you guys. So what do I do in those scenarios? Make your best guess when you don't understand your child. So, you know, your child is trying to communicate something, maybe he's not using a real word, maybe he is and it's not clear. So, you might want to understand out of the context, okay? Instead of asking him, you know, what are you saying? Tell me, are you talking about this? Are you talking about that? instead just pick up on whatever message he's trying to deliver through non-verbal mode and give him a word at that moment, yeah? And you would also want to start including choice questions to give him a word. So instead of asking him, what do you want? I can say, you know, do you want a phone or water? Okay, so that way he gets to say, here, water, he gets the auditory feedback and then he says water. And again, I would like to emphasize, at this stage of communication, you would want to have the preferred item of choice in the last. Okay, so don't keep, like, if I know my child wants water, I'm not asking, do you want water or phone? I ask him, do you want phone or water? Okay, otherwise, because then it wouldn't make sense to the child. And then also use gestures when you speak again. When a child says a word, what you would want to do is expand his message, okay? So now remember, this is a child who's already beginning to talk. So when he's saying like water, you can say, oh, drink water, right? So you're trying to add something to that and make it more communicative. And also if a child is mispronouncing a word, you would want to avoid correcting him. Because I think I've majorly seen parents doing two of these things. When a child is mispronouncing a word, they either model back the mispronounced word to them, like if the child is like, wah, wah, right, for water. So the child says, oh, my parent says, oh, you want wah, wah, right? So that is one scenario. Another scenario is, you know, they sit down and they're like, no, no, it's not wah, it's water, water. So what happens, and then you keep doing that and the child does not get water. You're giving him the message that, oh, I actually communicated wah, wah, in his head he's saying water, why did I not get water, right? So his intention begins to go down. Instead, what you would actually want to do is when he says wah wah for water, you say, oh, water, and then you actually give it to him. Instead of making it look like constant corrections, you make it look like, you know, you actually pick up his message and give it across. And which also means you need to give the right model of the word. Okay, so you don't want to keep saying wah wah because the child will never change the wah wah into water. So continue to say the right word, but in a more playful way. And then with sentences, a child who's already speaking in sentences, what would I work on is I would encourage more of storytelling, basic narrations, sequencing, like, you know, what do you do when you wake up? I would use a lot of visuals to promote those sequencing. I would show, like, you know, pictures. You can always show pictures if you're trying to get him to understand how he brushes. So, picture of that accordingly. And give your child a chance to initiate a conversation. Again, very important. We don't want them to only answer to our questions. We want them to be able to engage themselves in conversations when nobody else is actually coming to them. Because you have to remember, as adults, or, you know, as parents, you would be able to do that. But then when they go to school, they would just be by themselves when they don't know how to initiate. Okay, that's not what we want. We want them to engage. So work on initiations as well. And one way to help them do that is, you know, try to wait and see what activity they're picking, what word they're using, and then build up on that. Okay, so that will eventually enhance their initiations. And also start talking about printed words. This is very important to, you know, develop their literacy skills, which will finally, you know, help them out when they go into schools. So that's about basic language development. Moving on to play. I don't know how many of you here, but just by show of hands, tell me, do you actually think play helps to promote communication? Okay, I see a few hands and a few, you know, who are not. Playway. Yes, the playway is definitely the way to go. It does not mean, like, you know, for a child who's speaking sentences, I'm still going to stick to, you know, go chase the ball and come back. It's obviously, I'm going to stick to doing more age-appropriate kind of play. So why exactly is play essential? Is play is, you know, children's work. It's how they learn, right? If you make them sit, now, do you think any child, even if it was a typically developing 5-year-old child, and I make him sit here and I'm present, do you think he would pay attention? No. Instead, if I picked two skills from here and I sat down with him, you know, had a floor play and tried to teach him something, which one do you think he picks up better from? Exactly, the latter, right? So that's, and just because our kids aren't able to communicate to us that they do not like doing this, so they're not able to pick anything out of this, does not mean you continue to do that. Okay, what we're trying to do is enhance their communication, not deter. So play is definitely the way to go. And another reason why play is important, like just in communication, what communication has this turn taken? Like I ask her something and she responds back, and then, you know, she says something and then I comment back, right? And play is, and exactly plays what it, sorry, plays exactly what that promotes. It focuses on turn taking. Okay, so you know, it could be simple plays like I throw the ball and the child throws it back at me. That's turn taking again, which will, you know, enhance his communication skills in return. And yeah, obviously it's voluntary and it's more spontaneous than making him sit down and saying, oh look, showing him flashcards and oh what is this, apple, banana, orange. No, right? That's not how it works. And then it's more pleasurable and enjoyable, and obviously anything that's more enjoyable to the child, he's going to remember it longer, and also he's going to want to come and do it again. Okay? And it has no goals associated with it. It can be structured and unstructured play, but from the child's perspective, he just feels like he's in a more relaxed environment, so he might want to come to you much more. But in your head, you might, you know, I might do something really unstructured where I would just let the child chase another child and play around with absolutely no communication goals attached. Versus I might have some structured play activities arranged for my child, but then that's pertaining to me, not from the child's perspective. And also it involves active engagement on each part of the player. So play is definitely very important to teach a child anything at all. But you know, when you start playing, what you need to remember, the different plays you can do. You can do play with with people games, which is like, you know, peekaboo or running catch. You can do play with people toys, which is balloons, bubbles, wind-up toys. You can play with songs as well. Like I can sing rhymes and make it really fun for the child. I can play with toys, which includes, you know, different variety of toys like exchange toys, pretend play, and so on. And then followed by peer play, right? Now, what I want you guys to remember is obviously all of these qualify, and these are something that you want to promote with your kid. But one thing you might want to remember is when you actually sit down and pick an activity, you need to think about two things. Like, does my child know how to play with this? If the answer is yes, then you start adding communicative goals. If the answer is no, what you would want to do is first let him learn how, you know, how to play around with this toy. That is basically explore, show him how it's done. Like if I have like a maze and a car that goes through that maze and he just has no clue, he just takes a car and rolls it across him. I would want to show him how it's done instead of telling him, oh, put the car here. But, you know, put it on and then let it go. Wait, no. I would teach him how it's played. Now that I know that my child knows to play with this toy, then I would start working more on communication. Okay. And And also, now each child is different. Again, with play, they might be in different levels. This is in hierarchy. It starts off with exploratory play and then followed by rule-based games, right? Now, exploratory child might be at any of these stages. Most commonly, children with autism, depending on the stage of communication again, tend to be in exploratory play, especially when you get started, which involves, you know, smelling it, or just, you know, holding and looking at it, or lining up things and looking at it from different angles. So they are still looking at the toy, but it's more exploratory, right? They're not using it as it's supposed to be. But if a child is actually using it more functionally and knows the item's usage, he would qualify for functional play, followed by pretend play. So pretend play, as you all know, is just pretending to do something that doesn't exist in the environment. But these have two things. There's early pretend play skills and there's late pretend play. Early pretend play would be, you know, I have a spoon and I pretend to take the spoon and feed the baby. Okay, so that's early pretend. And then this slowly starts developing into later pretend skills, which involves, I don't even have a spoon, but I pretend to feed my friend. Okay, so understanding that abstract concept is also very important. And once a child is able to do that successfully, you would want to work on different role plays, like, you know, just exchange of roles, simple things like doctor, hospital-based role, doctor, patient, teacher, student, and all of those. And then again, there are board-based games. Rule-based games are basically any board that you play, you know, simple things like snakes and ladders, you know, that, you know, each one rolls the dice and then you move something, or even musical chairs. So all of these are different stages of play. Obviously, more higher stage of communication would be able to do these, or you might want to work on these. But when you're just getting started or you're not there yet, you might want to start focusing on the first two, on more functionality. Okay. Okay, so I hope all of you agreed and you know about the importance of using play with your children in sessions as well as at home. And then moving on to literacy. Early literacy skills are highly important. You know, a lot of us tend to focus on motor skills and speech skills, but I don't know how many of you have focused on early literacy skills. These skills, you know, they include prime print knowledge, sound awareness, story comprehension, vocabulary, and conversation. Print knowledge is basically, you know, when you start exposing the child to even simple things like books or some form of print, they need to begin understanding, okay, that the print actually goes from, I need to read from left to right. Okay, I need to keep the book in the right order and I don't keep it upside down. And all of that starts coming in. And then sound awareness, the child begins to understand that this particular sound, this particular alphabet stands for this sound. An R is an R, right? And it basically that it means something is what they need to begin to understand before you actually start working on hardcore literacy skills, okay? Follow a story comprehension. This is something you would all also want to work on because this, you could just have basic activities like looking at their ability to answer the questions, fill in the blanks, understanding what the characters feel, more abstract, high language skills like what are their feelings, or maybe this character is feeling hungry, or maybe he's feeling very sad, maybe he's going to the hospital because he's hurt. All those abstract kind of things, they start beginning, which will obviously again really help them out when they are ready for school. And again, vocabulary is, I'm sure all of you agree with that, is highly important. Like with a smaller vocabulary, the child is not going to be able to pick up on literacy skills as well. So greater the vocabulary, it's, you would be able to teach them more number of words with more print and so on. And then there is conversation. Conversation again, highly important to work on. Why it's qualifying for literacy skills is because, you know, when you have back and forth conversation with your kid, your child should be able to go to school and ask your teacher what he wants. Ask the teacher what he wants, and you know, or when the teacher is asking him to take out something, he says, okay, I will. You know, just that back and forth conversation you might want to start developing from a very young age. So early literacy skills are very important, and I know a lot of parents go into schools and they're like, oh, you know what, my child isn't doing any of these. So it would really help your child, or you know, to hinder his difficulties if you start working right from home. And basic suggestion would be you could, you know, if your child is just in preschool, you maybe pick the course book of a UKG and start working with, you know, working out at home and give him basic exposure to those. And you might also want to do a lot of book reading. Okay. And again, through that, they start developing interest in alphabets and letters and understanding that they actually mean something. I think we've almost come to the end of our presentation. What we're going to do is, we have a couple of questions that we usually see the parents, asking us in therapy. So we thought addressing it in a larger group would solve a lot of doubts. In addition to these, if you guys have anything at all, you can ask us towards the end. Yeah.
Okay. So these are the commonly asked questions for us in the clinical setup. So we picked about 6 questions, and the first 3 I'll be reading. Many of the parents ask us if AAC hampers development of speech and children. Any of you have that question? AAC is augmentative and alternative communication, which means that for children who have very minimal verbal language, we start working on other modes of communication. For example, use of picture exchange, Shenaz spoke about FECS, picture exchange communication system, use of simple picture boards, symbols or signs, even your AAC devices. AAC can be either aided or unaided. Unaided is what I spoke about until now. Use of picture symbols, boards, picture exchange communication system, all of that is unaided. Aided is use of devices, like I don't know if you've heard of a device called AVAS. Even in your tabs and iPads these days, you have softwares, AAC softwares that you can download that will help children to communicate their needs. So many a times we start with AAC for children despite a lot of attempt with verbal language training, they don't pick up. So then we start AAC. Either we can help them to point to what they want. Like for example, to talk about a very simple thing, we can start with a simple board which has 4-5 pictures of their basic needs. For example, a picture of water, a glass of water, picture of a toilet when they want to indicate their toilet needs, or picture of a park when they want to go to the park. And we can train them to point to the picture that point to the picture and express their need. So you want water, you point to the picture of the glass, so you get water. So this is especially helpful for children who are very minimal verbally, or who are developing at a much slower rate expressively, and their receptive language skills, their understanding skills are very good. So then we can work on AAC.
Child can indicate after pointing the child. But the thing is, with our children, any sensory issue occurs at that time. They are like shouting and they are not answering back to us what exactly what they want. At that point of time, is it really good to start PECS with an EEC or something, things like that?
Behavioral problems typically arise because children are not able to communicate. Every behavior is a communication. Every behavior is a communication. That is very beneficial. So, initially you may have resistance when you're starting off, but the moment they're able to understand that, okay, I'm actually getting my message across, she's able to understand what I'm saying and I'm getting what I want, then probably those should come down.
Just make some
definitely. It's a very structured program. PECS is very structured. So you have stages.
It's a
bi-speech.
Yes. Is it recommended that, or is it necessary that when we are teaching a child for basic cash card, cards, and you are pointing like this, girl is taking bath or the mother is taking washing utensils. So like you are pointing out the child is pointing one flash cards. Like so you are like bathing. You can say bath or bathing. So is it like important or necessary or strong that we are forcing the child to speak that word by scaring him, like by pinching him or by screwing his ears? So I've seen some therapy that screw in the ear, like screw your ear and bang on your head or something, scaring them. And this, they are thinking that children are speaking by that thread.
Right.
I feel that that is wrong.
Definitely.
And I pointed out the therapy that please don't do this thing with my son or don't teach me. I don't want your class.
Thank you. So evidence-based practices is something everyone is expected to follow, but what is just spoke about is putting the child under pressure to elicit a word. That usually doesn't work because only under pressure they will use the words, and later it is not used interactively. So you can pressurize the child and say, okay, you have to say it like how you said. We don't follow it. I'm just telling you, for example, under pressure he's going to tell you path. But then later he is not going to use it as a communicative function. He is not going to say, wow, look, the baby is bathing, or look, the duck is bathing in the pond. So interactive communication is what whatever Shenaz addressed throughout the presentation. We are looking at improving the child's interactive skills before working on their speech per se. So only when interaction develops, the child would want to come back to you and communicate what they've learned.
Because I pointed that
therapist,
she said that this is the way we work. But I don't know. I'm the first time I'm coming to this center. I don't want that my child should not say this. Please don't teach my child like this. If it's in a school also, I will say no. So, like, I don't want my child to speak by a threat. I don't want that. Please enjoy it. If you enjoy, don't speak, don't let him, don't force him. I'm paying him money. That doesn't mean that I have to utilize half an hour.
Parents, for you guys to make an informed decision if your therapist is actually doing, you know, what's supposed to be done. And if your intuition says it's not, then you might probably want to, you know, change the center or want to contact someone
who will actually be able to guide you better. Now also, you know, there are therapists who follow these with absolutely no research at all. And I also have parents who come and tell me like, you know, oh, look, have the safety pin and he doesn't behave, you know, actually poke him with it. And I'm like, no, that doesn't happen. So, you know, the parent, what they would probably end up doing is leaving the session. They're like, oh, you know what, it's not working out. But it's you know, it's a visual understanding that this is not the right way to go. And that's why I highly emphasize on playway. So playway, again, is not just sitting and, you know, running around the room. It's basically making the language more meaningful to the child and making it more interactive. And that way he will start, you know, using it accordingly.
But there are things that children are meant to be better than
speaking. But I'm saying, you know, not at all. Definitely. No, I'd like to clarify that's not the right way to go. Definitely not.
Excuse me, dear parents, first let them finish their presentation, then we'll go for the discussion. We are just deviating from the presentation. Thank you.
The next question that we frequently get is, if we start using signs and gestures as a part of therapy, then will my child never pick up speech and language? Do any of you have ever come across that? When you have a question. Okay, thank you. So, sometimes we use gestures and signs as a mode of communication for certain children. We like to begin with gestures and signs. The reason why we do that is gestures can be a big part, it can be a very big part both in predicting language and in promoting it, because in very young, typically developing children, gestures develop before development of spoken language. So that also indicates that the child is going to definitely pick up verbal language, and it also promotes verbal language development. So every time in our sessions, typically every time we're trying to teach a child a new word, for example, water or thank you or sorry, we try to pair it with an action. Because when a word is paired with an action, evidence and research has proven that the word spontaneous utterance of that word is the likelihood of the child spontaneously uttering the word is much higher than if you just teach the word alone. So gestures and signs do not hamper development of speech and language. They in fact promote it, and it's also one more point for many children. Gestures can even be their strength point. So when you begin using gestures, that can be their strongest point in their mode of communication. So they can pick up on that, and then slowly they can they might start getting words too.
Basically, yeah, I would like to add to that. Basically, what you're trying to do is again promote their intention to communicate, right? Which is very important. Like if your child is gesturing to you, just looking at the pen, and you don't pick that up, he's never going to start to learn to say pen. So a lot of parents fear that, oh, if I actually pick up on that communication, he's never going to say the word. That's not how it works. Looking at typically developing kids, like, you know, a child says, before he says bye, he actually begins to wave, and then he says bye, right? So it's not like, oh, why is my child waving? He should start saying bye. It's just basically.
And gestures are also very concrete. The reason being, words, I just say it in a spurt and it's over. But gestures are more concrete because I can hold a gesture for a longer duration. So that gives my child more time to learn to use the gestures than words.
In case the child might start faith, that is a longer duration. And as parents, we worry about it is using the gestures to make this work done for masking.
Communication is our ultimate goal. So we want the child to be
what the verbal kids not very verbal in their verbal, but use gestures.
One thing you can do is you can pair the gesture and the word, and as they are able to very successfully communicate, slowly you can fade out the use of gestures, and you can promote the use of words. You can prompt them to use the words more than the gestures. Gestures are also very easy because when they are just about to request something and you want them to say the word, you can even use the gestural prompt to get the word out.
I see regression.
Never research that thing of regression at all. Never is not using less words, more gestures. It's never been like that. It's either they will stay on the same level or they get better.
yes, we can wait for him to actually communicate using words, but how you wait is what matters. We don't want to push children off the edge and start, you know, developing behavioral problems. That's not what you want to do. You might want to wait more positively and more, you basically don't show to the child that you're, you know, you're expecting something of him. So you might want to cue to him, or you might even want to say the actual word and then, you know, wait for the child to repeat it back. Or I think what really works is when parents follow this 3-second rule. So you ask something and you wait, your child is unable to do that, you cue a little, it's still not happening, then give the word. It doesn't mean you just put the child in and you're not going to say open, I will not just that, I will just not let you go. You're, you know, put forever inside. But that word will bring in behavioral issues. That's not what you want to do. You'd rather, you know, successfully be able to develop communication by using the form.
Two more points for gestures. The brain, the parts of the brain that are responsible for development of spoken language, they also share with behavioral gestures. So that's the reason why one promotes the other. That's one point. And another thing I wanted to say is, language is very symbolic. That is, the words that we're using is very symbolic. It stands for something. The word, whichever word I use, it represents something or it stands for something. So similarly, your signs and gestures are also very symbolic. So by teaching them gestures, you're teaching them symbolism, that one thing stands for another. Even with play, it's likewise. In play, especially in written play, you teach them that you teach them to use a small spoon or a realistic spoon or a larger spoon. So you're symbolizing a spoon, or you say this is the plate and you have the form is the plate. So one thing stands for another. Again, you're working on symbolism. So language is all about symbolism, and the more you promote anything to do with symbolism, like using gestures, play, signs, it's definitely going to promote language, verbal language, and yes. Third question, are parent trainings effective and why? Anybody has a question? That's right, because research has shown that when parents are trained to use certain strategies with their children at home, they can work on par with the speech-language pathologist, and that the reasons are you are having much more spontaneous interactions with your children on a daily basis versus the interaction with the clinician is very structured. You have a 45-minute or a 1-hour session where you have planned activities versus at home you have more situations for spontaneous interactions, number one, and your daily routines. You do daily routines with your children every day, like brushing and bathing, putting on their shoes, taking them to school. So these are all wonderful opportunities where children, where parents can use whatever strategies they adopt in the parent training programs at into practice. And research has proven that it is extremely effective, and because parents are the child's first teacher. Next three questions, Himaja.
Fourth question is about oral motor therapy. Is it effective? So, how many of your therapists, speech therapists, do oral motor therapy? Here, oral motor therapy, what I mean is moving your tongue from one side to another, making a lot of clicking sounds, blowing candles. All these are non-speech oral motor exercises, we say, because they are not pertaining anything to speech. Okay, so basically, how many of your therapists do that?
So now all up here, what is non-speech oral motor exercises? Everybody?
So most of them, if you see, there was an Indian study that was done around 505 speech language pathologists. So basically they did an online survey in which they found that 91% of the population of SLPs were using non-speech oral motor exercises. And about 81% were using that to improve their speech intelligibility, that is basically pronunciation, like how she said. About 43% use that, for sensory problems. And about 30% use that thinking it might develop speech. Might. So the portion of might is still there. Okay. And few reasons why Indian SLPs use non-speech oral motor exercises are, one reason is because of our caseload. We have really large caseload when it comes to private clinics and hospitals. So you get a non-speech oral motor kits very easily, like horns, candles and everything. It's much more easier for therapists to do than to extensively prepare for the sessions. That's one of the reasons that's quoted in research. Secondly, the reason is that why it's not very helpful is something called task specificity. Task specificity is how much of positive transfer is happening when I'm doing a non-speech oral motor to my actual speaking. In English, we don't move our tongue from one corner of the mouth to the other corner. Neither we use clicking sounds for talking. Maybe in some tribal language it might be there, but how much is of those tongue moving and blowing we use that in actual language is never proven. So the task specificity does not happen actually speaking. So how much of these non-oral motor exercises help in actual speaking is still a question. And second thing is, considerable amount of research supporting it might help in strengthening muscles. But even when it comes to strengthening muscles, the kid is still eating well. But why is he not talking? Again, that's the question. Because the same articulators are responsible for eating. Why is the kid not able to talk? So there again it is a question. So please ask your therapist. See, ma'am rightly pointed out that my kid has CP, so there's muscle weakness. So my therapist is working on oral motor exercises. But whereas a kid with ASD, if you consider, maybe a kid with apraxia, associated apraxia, yes, they might work. But claiming to improve muscle strength for a kid with ASD is not right, actually speaking. So that time you really can question your speech therapist about why are they doing blowing, whether is it really to improve blowing, or whether is it to improve speech. So that you can always ask
my question. What happened in this 2 minutes? One speech therapist she also told me this. She told that he doesn't have any oral motor issues. Okay. I just can't name her. Other one what she told was that totally oral motor issues. Whom to believe, whom not to believe, I'm going to tell you. Both are award winning therapists.
Just making the kid raise the tongue to the alveolar ridge and the sound, making the sound. So that is the difference. But a lot of clinicians just stop with that. You know, just lift your tongue, like you have to see your kid is lifting the tongue, that's okay. So does it work like that?
Placement, like letting the child know where exactly he needs to place his tongue to be able to produce love. But that doesn't mean that I only, you know, take my kids for a session to put some honey on the tongue and keep touching it. There has to be some usage of that activity. That's what we're trying to say. And again, yeah, you know, it's not that oral exercises are wrong. Again, it's about who really needs it. Like, you know, if you see, basically, it's not for people, children with muscular weakness. And muscular weakness are kids. You might wonder, does my child have muscular weakness? If your child does not have drooling, if your child is able to walk around without support, if your child is able to run, able to, you know, use his hands with good dexterity, then probably no, he does not have muscular weakness. Okay? You know, you see drooling when the child isn't able to, like, pick an item and struggles a lot, when there's too much tightness or too much flaccidity, then we might want to work on muscular weakness based activities. Because that's when he really needs it.
Strength training for development of sounds is old philosophy. Earlier, in older days, they used to believe that if you train the speech muscles and if you make it stronger and if you improve the range of motion, then development of oral speech improves. That was the ancient thought, but later the recent research suggests that only 100 of strength is required, of the strength that you put in to move your muscles is actually required for speech. So that disproves that by training, by strength training of my speech muscles, I don't directly improve the speech. Probably my structures, the movement, and suppose I have swallowing issues, that might, it might facilitate for that. So suppose I'm not able to produce a certain sound, like he said, he's not able to lift up his tongue to say "lur." Help in those instances, but the speech musculature does not really require strength to produce sounds. It is more of a higher cortical thing.
Basically, language disorders, the categorization that you guys saw is someone I would not work with oral based things, right? If there is a speech disorder, then I would.
My son is verbal, but he doesn't have many of the oral skills. Like, he doesn't speak, he doesn't blow. I mean, blowing is like mild but not strong. He can't stretch his tongue out, he can't lift his tongue. He doesn't chew. From past 3 months, he has achieved moving the food inside the mouth from one side to other. But this forum, what kind of oral motor therapy actually helps in bringing this
skills in. Again, if your kid is having difficulty in feeding, in eating, then you need to work.
Okay.
But if you think tongue lifting and everything is disturbing his speech production, then you need not do it. Like you're telling he's had difficulty in chewing.
Yes.
Definitely your therapist needs to work on that. You can start off with soft foods and slowly move to pureed foods and then move on to hard foods. That training should definitely be given. But what is the reason you want your child to blow?
No, even the candle blowing, he doesn't do it properly.
So doesn't do it properly meaning sometimes he does it?
No, the force will not be proper.
That's what I'm telling. That much of force required, the strength required to blow a candle is not necessary for you to actually produce speech.
No, he is verbal. But the other skills I'm talking about, like blowing a balloon.
You want him to develop blowing
yes.
skills. Yeah, then if your goal is to develop blowing skills, you can work on blowing skills. There's no harm in it. But you need not pay for a session like you typically work on blowing skills. You might as well keep a candle and work and focus. What is the reason behind using that?
And my child also keeps grinding his teeth a lot. So, is it because of his sensitivity or
sensitivity.
So, this massages will help him to reduce
massages might help.
If a child is experiencing some oral under-sensitivity issues, sensory issues, then they would start working on things like you said, like, you know, massages, vibrations, and things like that, T-tubes, yeah, they would probably focus on those. And if you, you know, want to enhance your child's oral motor, you can definitely pick up skills. And, like, you know, if he doesn't have enough strength to blow, then you might want to give him more feedback. You could do it, like, you know, by making just bits of paper and having closer to the mouth and see how much it blows out. First model and see how much more, like how much, like you would have a plate and show him that, see, when you blow, the papers are all gone, there's none left on the paper. So basic feedbacks like that would, you know, let him understand that he's not blowing enough and let him try out.
Thank you. one form or the other. It will be there in one form or the other. That's true. That's the thing. It will be there in one form or the other. But you can make it meaningful. You can do a lot of activities that involves rhyming words and anything that really, you know, involves him.
Respond very well when you're inside the session. That usually happens with a couple of kids.
You might still want to be informed about what goals have been happening. You know, I usually, maybe if I have parents in India, I could even sit right outside my room. They can at least see, you know, hear whatever is going on. So that really helps. When you start doing that, and in addition, there are also plenty of parent programs. And one such program that also has certified is handled by the birds. You know, again, we take various programs like that to get better equipped when you have strategies, when you practically implement everything you learn, and then when you start becoming more independent. So remember, as parents, when you go into therapy, the primary goal there is to eventually withdraw from therapy. It's not a lifelong thing that you're going to do. We cannot put that down. It depends on how much. Like, I recently discharged a 3.5-year-old kid. But I was able to discharge a 5-year-old kid, right? So it depends on how, skills are developing. And this kid, it's not like he was 100% good to go, but I know that the parents know how to go on. And I also give them like a home plan that they follow for like 3 months and they always come back. So you might want to go into things like that.
Ask his needs independently. He must be able to use this particular ADC device and ask for all of his needs. So once that need is met and he's able to generalize that with as many people as possible in school, at home. So that is that particular child's long-term goal. But for yet another child, that may not be the long-term goal. For another child who just has social pragmatic issues, my goal might be to work on helping him to start conversations, maintain conversations. Once he has achieved that and the parents are able to carry that back, they're able to work on it very well, like how Shenaz said, then we would discharge the child and only have follow-up visits. So it is not prescribed time, prescribed age, prescribed goals. It depends on that particular child's basic capabilities and abilities and what we are looking at from long-term point of view.
Okay, and if I continue to take therapy, like my primary goal, like she said, just expanding on that, was to basically help, like he communicates what he wants, like he's using a device, and I want him to communicate using eye pointing and detect, pick whatever item he wants. And he's done that, and then I generalize, I pick a lot more items, and he's able to do those successfully. What next? Like, do I just keep going on and on, and he does the same thing again back in sessions? Why am I still not withdrawing him? Okay, now the parents know that you have the device, you're better equipped. You need to expose a child in different environments and take it back home. Okay, so you basically, it all comes down to how well informed are you as parents. Okay, only then will you, sometimes there are parents who have discharged and they go like, no, I don't think I can do this, right? So you also have to start feeling confident. So take steps to be able to start feeling confident to work with a kid.
He is in the state of talking in sentences, and the only problem we're facing with him is self-talk. When he is not in an activity, when he is not in front of a book, or when he is not in front of a writing or something, or in front of anybody, he stays in an idle time. He starts talking about whatever he has seen on the TV. Now he has stopped his gadgets also, but still he remembers that when he talks the same modulation, the same dialogues, everything. I can't stop it. And now it is affecting his learning in the classroom. When the teacher is giving him, if it is in a one-to-one, he is done. I mean, he doesn't work properly. The teacher talks something, she is discussing something, then he starts talking. So that's what complaining. I don't know how to stop that.
Self-talk is a very, very persistent problem we see across children, but the reason may be that they're very self-stimulatory by nature. It's a sensory issue. But
it's not a sensory issue.
Okay, so let's consider that this is not a sensory issue. Some of the things that you could do is, see, you're saying that his language is normal, but still, apart from work time, he's not doing it. Don't ever put a full stop to his learning, like in terms of vocabulary development.
I didn't say that he's completely okay.
I understand. Self-talk sometimes occurs when children are having only very limited content and they're replaying it in their own minds.
Yeah.
So I saw this advertisement and I'm replaying it again and again. I went to this particular grocery store and that stuck in my head. I'm replaying it again and again. So I don't know. say, his cognition and his language expands. So that way, the self-talk may come down. Because see, for example, you said even in school, this is happening from listening in class.
Yeah.
It's very classical because the more and more he self-talks, the lesser and lesser he hears,
yes,
and the lesser he learns, and the lesser he knows, and so it's going to become a cycle. It's going to become more self-talk. So rather than rehabilitating, I mean, rather than trying to obliterate the self-talk, you try to increase the things that he knows. Yeah, try to increase his language, try to increase his vocabulary.
And he's very conscious, and I say, Adi, he'll say, quiet time.
Yeah.
He himself will say, Amma, quiet time.
That's because you paired it up with always paired it saying, you know, shh, so he quiet time, be quiet time. And it's out of his control because he doesn't really know what to do when he's by himself.
Yes.
So working, if you prepare your recipe, work with the cognitive skills.
Okay.
As a parent, as well, at the moment, a few things you could do is, one, if you see him, doing a lot of self-talk, what you would want to do is just get down on the floor with him and join him, okay? So what happens when you do that is the self-talk that he's doing becomes more like parent talk and it's more interactive and communicative. So what you do there is, in that instant is, yes, you can always maybe probably distract him all that by bringing in something, that's one thing. But I think it would work better if you actually join in and discuss about whatever he's talking. Like if he's saying, if he's just calling all the attendants from school, then you could say, oh yeah, there is. You just make it interactive, asking questions about it. Since he's verbal and he looks like he's, he comprehends questions, you can actually start asking.
If I start talking with him, if I'm, as you said, talent work, he'll shift and he'll go on. He doesn't want to have the balance.
That's
he wants to be his thing. He wants to continue to speak.
The best thing would be to introduce vocabulary that he totally doesn't. Like, for example, things you see animals. It may be something that's really that is not in his vocabulary. It may be totally novel.
Yeah.
So introduce novel vocabulary. Like, see animals, plants, and so on. That might be a very distracting thing. It may be a way from both ways.
And also to, one thing is, you try to reduce it, but another thing you can do is always enhance, look at this as a strength and then try to work on it. So what you can do, remember to do in future when you're trying to teach him some skill or trying to teach him some concept out of his books, you would want to stick to, it looks like he's more rote memory,
yeah,
right? So you might want to stick to this pattern, teach him something new. So you can always remember that as a pointer. You teach him new things in future, you can always use this modality. And then of course, self-talk carry it.
How is it about he's not doing it in school? He comes home, he says, for example, he says, subscribe to a rich meeting. Just like this way, you want to do it.
He's not doing it in school, maybe it could be he's more occupied, or they might. You actually have to be very observant to notice that he's actually being making sound and doing self talk. So maybe the teachers are not picking it up, that could be one possibility. Or maybe he's not as idle of when he's paying attention to the kids around. So at home, again, what you can do is I suggest you get down with him and talk about whatever he's talking and make it more meaningful than self talk.
He's not able to express under pressure. He is able to do that, but the skills of the he knows it, but he's not delivering it. So he had a problem like he's still in 2 years. So he's able to communicate only single words. So what do you do?
So you're going to
is going to be able to do whatever he is mediating.
Notices you, you can start building up those imitations. So now you can do something else.
that is, you can start your own imitation game and not wait for him to do something. Okay, so it becomes back and forth. And another reason, and even then he might or might not be able to imitate you. So what you would want to do is maybe you could help him out or have a person from behind, a third person who actually helps him imitate. Basic hand-over-hand assistance will go a long way. Make sure you're doing the drink, but he's not doing it. So what you might want to do is assist him in doing the imitation, and then follow up with a couple of times. So repeated, pick up 5 gestures, 2 weeks or so, and work with those back and forth. And when you're starting off, show him how it's done. Then you give hand over hand, and then he might then start becoming more independent.
Ask for all his needs. I want this, I want that, but the moment we ask the question, he would what's your name? So what I do is, I would take the child's hand and put it across his chest and say, but Shakti, what's your name? Shakti. And then I go, what's your name? I don't say anything and people say Shakti, right? So it would really help if you add a sign or a gesture to that. Now, sometimes it might not be always feasible to add a gesture, like, you know, what you do for just anything. So in that case, what you can do, even do is, you can have a tap, a simple tap, right? So you're like, oh, who is that? If the person is not, who is sleeping, you might not obviously have a dog around, or if it's not a picture or whatever, just giving an example. You might just want to tap the name and say, dog. Okay, then you ask again, who is that? A doggy. And then you ask the question, wait, I'm sure. And what you have to do is, make sure you take the child, do that same physical action, but don't say anything. The child will repeat that word. It always works.
Best thing would be to start with here and now questions. That is two things that are in context, in the immediate environment. Like, what is this? What are you eating? Or, you know, simple questions where the answer is just within the immediate environment. Because to think and answer is another role, that's a role of cognition. Thinking about the past, thinking about something which doesn't exist. Abstract can be another extra role. That's you can work on it once here and now is achieved. For example, you don't start with, did you go to school today? Yes. And then he's going to say yes. But we really don't know if he processed, did you go to school today? So we know he processes that only if he's doing the year and answering the year and now questions without the question.
Only questions, right? It has a considerable number of things that there are yes no questions, there are choices, there are comments, which is very important. Which I see, I don't see a lot of parents following that. So if you're doing a book with a child and you turn the page, you're like, who is this? And then you know, oh, what's going on? And instead, what you can do is, well, look, there's a boy, he's jumping. When you do things like that, you can always go down on your questioning. Basically, what you need to do, like if you have a one target, only do one questions.
Okay.
And other than that, do a lot more comments. So he starts picking up on that, and you know, it's more meaningfully established.
To add to that, sorry, empathy is a favorite topic. Yeah. And if you're asking one question, try to make sure you're giving four comments. Always your question to comment ratio should be four. One is to four. Like she said, when you go with food, you say, hey, wow, look, that's a chocolate ice cream. So I would give four comments before I ask one question. Because we're always testing the child.
Yeah, don't test the child. What it comes down.
throwing fit at him. How do I help him with abstract emotions or color human nature, brain nature? These are things which we cannot really teach them. How do we really? So two things. One is how do we help him encourage storytelling? Second thing, abstract part, how do we do?
Abstract concepts, storytelling, all of this falls under what we call as theory of mind. Theory of mind means being able to predict or talk about someone else's feelings and emotions, and talking about your own feelings and emotions, taking perspective, somebody else likes something different. Not everybody likes what I like, and somebody else may like what I dislike. Those are the things you're talking about, right? So those are higher than the skills which we call as theory of mind. So there are multiple stages in this itself, and it takes a lot of effort to work on it step by step. So some suggestions that I can give you is, you can use a lot of mental state words when you're talking to your child on a daily basis. Like, for example, mental state words are words like think, feel, remember, forget, like, don't like.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think again what I would do is supplement the prompts with something visually. Okay, so if I'm talking about an apple, I'm expecting him to say apple, instead of telling him, I would have a picture. Okay, because auditory, feeding of auditory modality is not harder than the visual modality. Plus, when what happens is when I'm constantly cueing him with the auditory modality, why that's happening is because he's not picking it up, and again, the ideas are very abstract for him. Okay, so you can give more permanence to the thoughts he has and whatever he knows by using visuals. That itself, and then while you're doing it, put down on your authority. The presence of visual itself will enhance his cognition and his thinking, and the ideas will become more confident. So start with visuals and become visuals, not just thinking about kids. I think visuals all around really helps to keep the kids in loop with what's happening, you know, just to give more comments to ideas and such. So start with the visuals around at home.
Gracias.
we'll wind up the session. First and questions you can ask me, okay? Once it's over. But when you're going, please, for 5 minutes, okay? We'll finish giving gifts to them. After that, we'll say some thanks to our volunteers. When you're going out, you're picking your kids, please don't forget to say thanks to the volunteers. The young men and women, they are in the leave on the Sunday, they are there to help us. So when we are not paying anything for them, out of interest, out of helping tendency, they are coming, okay? So please thank them before picking your child. As a token of love, we are giving a small gift to three speakers, Himaja, Shenaz and Monica. Actually, normally we used to call father or illati parent, mothers are kudum, but in the tharava, we wanted to encourage more fathers. Okay? So this session we are giving gift to the speakers with fathers. Adapathina, Mr. Vijay, the father of Kavin, he always prepares PowerPoint for me for our group. So he's contributing his first group. So we want more men to be part of our team. So I call upon Mr. Vijay to give away the momentum to Shenaz. Also.
Thank you very much. I hope this session was useful, very useful to you. Thank you.